In this section of the course, we'll learn how to perform a retrospective review of your analytical system and how frequently this review should occur. Now that you're familiar with total error plots, let's move on to how to perform retrospective reviews. The analytical process is never static. Instruments, operators, and conditions in the laboratory change over time. This means that the components of the quality management system, for example, laboratory performance and statistical process control SPC rules, should be reviewed on a regular basis to ensure continued suitability. How often should a review of the system happen? Ideally, a review should be performed each month. However, if a laboratory does not have the resources to complete a monthly review, a quarterly review should be performed. A separate review of the laboratory's chosen quality specifications, based on biological variation, should take place at least annually. When a laboratory performs a review, it should always consider the following questions. Does the mean or standard deviation need to be adjusted? Can the rules used for acceptance or rejection of the data be modified? Is the total allowable error specification appropriate for the test? What does analysis of the total error plots indicate? Let's look at each of these questions in more detail. Let's start here. A laboratory can have an apparently satisfactory statistical process control system in place. However, if the mean and/or standard deviation are incorrectly calculated, any quality planning or process control will be ineffective. When establishing a mean for a new lot of QC material, a minimum of 20 measurements should be made on 20 separate days. The measurements should be collected when the test system is known to be stable. To determine if the test system is stable, the new lot is run in parallel with the lot currently in use. When a test system is stable and QC data from an existing lot has been generated over an extended period of time, then the existing SD can be used for the new lot of control when the analytes have similar target values. When no such QC data exists, then, like the establishment of the mean, the SD should be estimated using 20 measurements collected on 20 separate days. An estimate of the SD based on only 20 measurements might vary up to 30% from the true SD. For this reason, a more representative estimate should be obtained using cumulative data from longer periods of time. As the 20 measurements used to calculate either the mean or SD is collected, possible day-to-day sources of variability should be included. Some of these sources are daily and weekly maintenance, multiple reagent changes, especially reagent lot changes, multiple recalibrations, calibrator lot changes. Since lyophilized controls require reconstitution, which can result in the possibility of more vial-to-vial variation, it's recommended that the 20 measurements be derived from 20 different bottles of control. Let's continue with the next question. Can the SPC rules used for acceptance or rejection of the data be modified? To answer this question, proven methods for selecting appropriate SPC rules should be used. For example, BIORAD's Westgard Advisor Program uses the concept of TEA as a quality specification. This use of TEA evaluates whether opportunities exist to adjust the SPC rules. A few key points to consider are: if a test's performance is better than the selected quality specification, then little quality control is required. Use of single rules, such as 1-3S, 1-3-5S, 1-4S, or even higher may be considered. When a test's performance is at or near the quality specification, then stricter rules and/or multi-rule schemes may be needed. When a test performs worse than the quality specification, a procedural correction is required, a change in technology, methodology, or laboratory practice. For all of your laboratory QC needs, go to www.qcnet.com.